Often you need to fetch data from remote hosts. A very productive way to do this is to establish a private and public key pair and use that for authentication. In this unit, we'll see how you can create such a key and use it to log into a remote host, and how you can create shortcuts to cut down on tedious typing. We'll also see how we can execute commands on a remote host, how we can copy the output of commands between hosts, and how we can jump over a firewall. A safe and trouble-free way to log into a remote host is through a public-private key pair. The public key is something that you share with others and store in the remote host, while the private key is something you keep to yourself and store in your local host. The private key is a secret that establishes your identity to the remote host. Let's see how you can create such a key pair.
Let's suppose I'm on a host in London. I first move to my home directory. Here I will create and store my pair of public and private keys. To do that, I need to create a subdirectory named .ssh to store my pair of keys. I change to .ssh and run the command sshkeygen. This command is used to generate a new pair of public and private keys. For the generation of the keys, some complex math calculations are performed behind the scenes. I'm then prompted to enter the filename where my private key will be stored. The default filename given by the program is id_RSA. For further protection, I can also enter a passphrase, as you can see. This protects the key against users with administrative access to the current host, because without the passphrase, my private key cannot be accessed. Next, my private key is stored in the file id_RSA. Be careful! This file must be kept secret. Similarly, my public key is stored in the file id_RSA.pub. I can display its contents using the cat command and use it as I like. There's no need to keep the public key secret. For example, I can distribute it to other hosts, specifying that whoever knows the private key that corresponds to my public key can access the host.
Let us now see how we can log into the remote host with our private key.
Let's now suppose that I'm remotely logged into a host in Paris. I need to specify that from the London host, where I previously created my pair of public and private keys, I can access the Paris host. I move to my home directory again and create another .ssh subdirectory. Under .ssh, I create a file named authorized keys with a cat command. I then append to this file the public key I created in my previous example. In this way, whoever owns the private key that corresponds to my public key can remotely log into the Paris host. In this case, it's the London host which has my private key and can access the Paris host. To verify that, let's move back into the host in London. The SSH command stands for Secure Shell. This is a protocol and program used to securely connect to a remote server or system. SSH is secure in the sense that it transfers the data between the host and the client in encrypted form. In our example, I use SSH to log into the Paris host and execute the command hostname. Here, the first argument of SSH is where I want to log in. The second argument is the command I want to execute on the remote host. By running the particular SSH command on my London host, we get as output paris.example.com because the hostname command is executed on the Paris host.
It's often useful to use a different key on different hosts. Here is an example of how we can do this to access a computer hosted on Amazon's AWS Elastic Computing Cloud.
In order to log into a remote host, we can use the SSH command with the -i option. This option allows us to specify which identity file to use in order to establish a connection with a particular host. In this example, I use a private key named EC2ID RSA that was generated by the Amazon Web Services. With that key, I log as a user named EC2User on a host on the AWS cloud. There, I can run a cat command to display the message of the day. Instead of specifying the same key every time we want to log into a particular host, we can configure SSH to always use a specific key with a specific host. To do that, we create a file named config in the SSH directory. In this file, for each remote host, we first specify a host identifier of our choice. Here, I use AWS. Then, we use the actual host name and the name of the user if this differs from the remote one. In my case, the user is EC2User. Lastly, we specify the identity file to use, which in this case is EC2ID RSA. Now, instead of typing the initial long command, I can simply run and type SSH, AWS cat, etc. MOTD, and the output we get is the same as before.
Having set up public-private key authentication, let's see a few examples of how we can use it through SSH.
Let's first establish where we are. Running hostname, we see that I'm on the Amsterdam host. Running date, we get the current date and time in Amsterdam. Now, I use the SSH command to log into the New York host. If we don't specify any command as an argument to SSH, we get an interactive shell. So, the dollar sign we see here comes from the New York host. We can verify that by running hostname again. As expected, the output is ny.example.com. Similarly, typing date, we get the date and time in New York now. From the New York host, I can log in back to Amsterdam. This is possible because I have also established trust with the private-public key pair in the reverse direction. I run SSH amsterdam.example.com and specify the command I want to execute there. As usual, I display the message of the day, "Welcome to Amsterdam." Furthermore, we can pipe the output of SSH to another command. For example, I remotely log into the Amsterdam host and count the number of users hosted there. I run cat on /etc/password and pipe the output to word count. /etc/password is a text file that contains the attributes of the users on a Unix machine. We see that there are around 1,000 users set up on the Amsterdam host.
Amazingly, we can pipe output from one SSH session to another.
Let's see some examples. Consider the case where we want to backup a directory named work directory to a tape drive located on another host. I use tar to create an archive of the work directory. I then pipe the output of the SSH command specifying my backup server. I also include the dd command, which surprisingly stands for copy and convert. Its name came from the data definition statement in IBM's job control language. You may also hear DD jokingly referred to as disk destroyer or delete data. Because when DD is used for low-level operations on disks, a small mistake can lead to the loss of the data on a disk. In general, DD copies an input to an output. In our case, the input is the archive of the work directory. I specify as an output file the device where the tape drive exists, devst0. I also use a block size of 1 megabyte. This is required for the tape drive to stream data without a problem. When we want to recover our backup data, we SSH to the backup server. Again, I use the dd command, but this time I specify the tape drive as the input file. Next, I pipe the output to tar to extract the work directory. As another example, I use tar again to create an archive of my work directory. Then, I SSH to another host and extract the archive there. In this way, we can copy directories from one host to another.
We can also use SSH in order to traverse a firewall.
Here is an example. I use the curl command to access a directory on the remote host ldap.example.com. For the TCP port, I specify the port 389. This is the default port of LDAP for listening to queries. Running the curl command, we get as output after a while that curl is unable to connect to the remote host. The connection has timed out. The problem here is that there is a firewall between the host I use and the host ldap.example.com. Here is how we can traverse the firewall. Let's assume that I have access to another host named shell.example.com that can actually access the port 389. I run SSH on shell.example.com, including the sleep command for about 10,000 seconds. The minus L option to SSH is used to specify that the local port 8389 will be available on host ldap.example.com port 389. As a result, anything sent to the local port 8389 goes to shell.example.com and from there to ldap.example.com port 389. Next, I run curl again, specifying the local host port 8389 instead of the remote host along with the query I want to execute. This runs beautifully because it goes to shell.example.com and from there to ldap.example.com. When I'm done, I need to kill the SSH process. To do that, I first run ps for process status to see the processes that are currently running. I notice that SSH has the process ID 27803. In order to kill it, I simply run kill 27803. Indeed, running ps again, we verify that the SSH process is no longer running.
Another nifty command that takes advantage of SSH and public-private key authentication is rsync.
We previously saw how we can use tar and SSH to copy a complete directory hierarchy from one host to another. Sometimes we want to keep two identical directory hierarchies in sync between two hosts. Copying the complete contents each time is wasteful and expensive, both in terms of bandwidth and time. The rsync command, which stands for remote sync, allows us to keep in sync two directories. In this example, I keep in sync the contents of the directory users share sounds alsa, which exists on the host remote.example.com, with a local directory named WAV files. Running rsync, the remote files are copied to the local WAV files. Now, next time I run rsync, it finishes quickly because it has no update to make. It only sends about 20 bytes and receives around 200 bytes to verify that indeed nothing has changed. Listing the local directory WAV files, we see that all remote files we included are here. Now, let's remove one file from the local directory, for example noise.wav, and, after removing it, repeat rsync to see what happens. Rsync copies again the removed file noise.wav from the remote host to the local directory. That's how rsync works. It's very useful for maintaining backups and for synchronizing file copies between different hosts.
This concludes our unit on fetching data from remote hosts. Stay with us.